Is it open? Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. Okay, let N and P be primes, like in the previous talks. So just greater or equal to 2, not necessarily 5. And so P divides again the numerator of N minus 1 over 12. And so fix a surjective homomorphism logarithm from Fn star to Fp. So I fix it for the rest of the talk. So let K naught. This is the group, the number field defined by in the previous talk, Q zeta p zeta n p. So this is a subfield of Q zeta p zeta n, the cyclotomic field, which contains Q zeta p and the index is, so, you know, I mean, so yes, the degree is p. And so let me begin by talking about something which has a priori no relation with the Hessenstein ideal, just about the class group of K naught. Let's see. This is so class group of K naught mod p, and you take the inverse of Teschmuller action. Okay, like in the previous talk. And let R Rp be the rank of C as Fp vector space. So here the theorem due to Wake and Wong-Erikson, and also due to myself independently. So Rp is greater or equal to 2. This is equivalent. If P is, okay, assume that P is greater than 2 pi in this case. So the sum, so the order of zeta here. Okay, this is what essentially was stated in the previous talk. So there is an action of the Galois group of Q zeta p over Q on this class group, and you want that there is an inverse of Teschmuller action on this. Okay. And so I will just state an some condition which is completely equivalent. So sum for k in z over nz star, b2 bar k over n times log k is congruent to 0 mod p. So b2 bar is the second Bernoulli periodic function. So it's a function from R to R given by b2 bar of x. This is just b2 of fractional part of x, where b2 is a classical Bernoulli polynomial, x squared minus x plus 1 over 6. Because this is essentially the quantity, the logarithm of the quantity defined by Merrell. So here is a conjecture. So Rp is greater or equal to I if and only if for all j less than I, we have sum of b2 bar k over n log k j is 0 mod phi k in z over n zeta. I think this is just equivalent to the order of zeta go too high. Um, So this should follow from a conjecture of gross and refined class number formula, but for the moment, I have no proof. Maybe it should be possible. For I equals 1, this is the previous theorem. And for I equals 3, maybe there is a way to prove it using my results and combining it with the result of Wake and Wong-Erikson. Okay. So now I can talk about the Eisenstein ideal. So let GP. This is the rank of the echo algebra T not defined in the previous talk. So this is an integer equal to 1. So the theorem of Merel. GP is greater than equal to 2. This is equivalent to order of zeta greater than equal to 2. This is equivalent to RP greater than equal to 2. What Merel really did, he proved that GP is greater than equal to 2 if and only if this quantity is 0 mod P. And so by the theorem of Wake and Erikson, this is equivalent to this thing on the class group. Sorry, the con- okay, it's a plus one something. A equals one, this is the previous theorem. I equals two, maybe there is the hope to find the proof.
Is there a way to understand what this quantity represents?
Yes, it's the Mayer-Tate derivative, like the zeta value at s equals minus one, the higher the order of vanishing. Yes. Yeah.
So what's the order zeta?
Zeta is an element in the group ring ZP Z over N star, and so this condition is equivalent to the vanishing of this quantity. Okay. This is equivalent. So the order of zeta is equal to I. This is equivalent to zeta is in the I's power of the augmentation ideal, and this is equivalent to the vanishing of some quantities like this.
Now that R is bigger than equal to I, should also have a plus one.
So the aim of this talk is to understand the rank of Mayer-Eisenstein ideal. So I will give my main result about GP now. Remember, in the previous talk, we have seen that GP is greater than equal to 2 if and only if this quantity vanishes. And so now I'm saying that GP is greater than equal to 3 if and only if this quantity and this quantity vanish. and so conjecturally, so we get GP is greater than equal to 3 if and only if RP is greater than equal to 3, if I assume this this conjecture. But then it's false that GP is greater than 4. It's not at all equivalent to RP greater than 4. It breaks here. I will speak a bit about the case where P equals 2 and P equals 3. So for P equals 3, this is a theorem of Merel also. GP is greater than equal to 2 if and only if sum for k equals 1 to n minus 1, k squared times log k, 0 mod 3. Okay. But then I'm not sure if there is a like an interpretation of this in terms of the cyclotomic class group. I mean, Caligari and Emerton show that this is related to the class group of Q zeta 3 square root of n, I think, yeah. But it's not related to some cyclotomic class group. But maybe it is, I just don't know. And also my theorem, so the analog of this theorem for P, yes, P is greater than 5 here. So mainly in the talk, P will always be greater than 5, but just now I'll just state some results. If P equals 3, then GP is greater than 2, this is equivalent to 3. So this is equivalent to the vanishing of these two quantities, at least if n is congruent to 1 mod 27. If n is only congruent to 1 mod 9, it's not quite clear. There is some log of cube root of unity, which I can compute, but not quite explicitly. So okay. So this is the quaternion for p equals 3, and I will give the quaternion for p equals 2 now. So this is a very beautiful result of Caligari and Emerton. This is just to explain to you that the rank of the Hecker algebra is related for small values of to class groups. P equals 2, GP is greater than. So GP is given by an explicit formula where R is just the R is the two-adic valuation of the class group of Q square root of minus M. Okay, so this is a complete determination of GP in this case. Okay, so essentially the aim of the talk is to explain how I prove this result and how in general I can hope to get some information about this rank. So the method I will use is the theory of higher Eisenstein's elements. So you take M a T module, like quite general T module, and then you want to understand the elements of M which are annihilated by a power of the Eisenstein ideal. So I is the Eisenstein ideal. So to be more precise, we have the following like existence theorem. So I will take an arbitrary Hecker module, which is not trivial. Is locally free of rank one at the Eisenstein ideal. And I will construct a sequence of elements in it, which are these elements will be annihilated by a power of the Eisenstein element, the Eisenstein ideal. So, so just T, this is a ZP Hecker algebra acting on M2 or gamma naught of N. So, contrary to the notation of the previous talk, I don't localize the Eisenstein ideal. This is really the Hecker algebra. And so there is a quotient, which is T naught, the cuspidal Hecker algebra. And so the kernel is just generated, is free of rank 1 because n is prime. So this is generated by some Hecker operator T naught, just because n is prime. And so we have the following theorem. Let M be a free ZP module which is also a T module. Locally free of rank one at the SHI ideal. The maximal SHI ideal for residual characteristic P. There exists some sequence of elements E0, E1, EGP, where GP is the rank of the algebra, in M mod PM, so this is only in characteristic P, which satisfies the following Hecker relation, such that for all L not N prime, we have TL minus L minus 1 EI. This is a multiple of EI minus 1. Okay, so I have to be a bit careful. So for all I to 0, and so this is only modulo the subgroup generated by the previous element. So modulo E0, E1, I minus 2. And so by convention, E minus 1 is just 0 by convention. Okay, so this is.
Your T is just the
Hecker
algebra tensor with ZP.
Yes, with ZP. Yeah. It's not completed at all at this time. Okay, so just some. Okay. I will make some comments on the theorem. Some comments. So E0 is killed by the SHI ideal. So it is proper of the action of Hecker operators. Because you take I equals 0, minus 1 is 0, so E0 is killed by TL minus L minus 1. EI is unique only modulo E0, EI minus 1. For example, E1, I want the it is defined, it is characterized by the Hecker relation like this. But if I add a multiple of E0 to E1, then it doesn't change this relation. So E1 is only well-defined mod E0. E1 is killed, of course, by the square of the SHI ideal. E2 is killed by the cube of the SHI ideal, and so on. Also another remark is that you have a notion, if you have any Hecker module like this, you have a notion of the cuspidal part of the module. Like if you have this module of modular forms, then you have the space of cuspidal modular form. If you have the relative homology of the modular curve, you have the notion of the absolute homology, and so on. We have this fact that E0, all the higher SH chance elements here are in the cuspidal part, except the last one. So I will define. Consider particular cases for M, and in all the cases, so it will be clear what the cuspidal part is. But like the cuspidal part is M0 is just the set of elements of M killed by the Hecker operator T0 here. Okay, this is the definition of the cuspidal part. This is the cuspidal part. But EGP is not. So somehow, for example, E0 and E1 always exist, and you have that GP is greater or equal to 2 if and only if E1 is in the cuspidal part. So if you understand E1, or at least you understand whenever E1 is in the cuspidal part, then you understand when GP is greater or equal to 2. This is why if if you understand or you can compute these elements, you can have information about the rank GP. Yeah, okay, yeah, indeed. It's a strange notation, but I mean, often you have a duality between the module that we consider.
No,
GP will be just always the rank of the Hecke algebra. M it's a global Hecke module, right? It's not something completed at some ideal. So for example, M will be the space of modular forms. Okay, just one last remark. So these elements live only in characteristic P. You see there are elements of M, not PM. But the only so of course you can always lift them in an arbitrary way to M, but they won't satisfy any Hecke relation. But you can lift E naught to characteristic zero to an element which is also which is killed by the Eisenstein ideal. So okay, there exists E naught tilde in M, such that TL E naught tilde is L plus one E naught tilde. So this is unique up to scalar, and this is a way to lift E naught. But you cannot lift E1 and so on. This is really our elements on characteristic P. And also, last remark, you can do all this theory about P power T when T when P power T divides N minus 1 over 12. But I, for simplicity, I will stick to, I will work just about P today. So you could get so information about the Newton polygons that way. But I will just get today information about GP. So this is not a very deep theorem. It's just essentially a commutative algebra plus the results of about the structure of the Hecke algebra. So yeah, it's not very interesting, but so there are four cases of interest to us for the choice of M. And so the aim will be to try to compute as much as higher Eisenstein's elements as possible in concrete cases. So yeah, I didn't say it, but these are called the higher Eisenstein's elements of M. And E naught or E naught tilde is just the Eisenstein element. Okay, so the first case is the space of modular form. So M, this is the set of modular form in gamma naught, whose Q expansion, whose Fourier coefficients are in ZP at infinity. So for n, an of f is in ZP. So maybe the constant term is not in is maybe not integral, but it's not important. I won't check the hypothesis of the theorem, namely that M is free, locally free of rank one, but it will be true in all the cases I will do. Okay, so in this case, so you denote by F naught, F1, FGP, the higher Eisenstein's elements. So F naught tilde, this is the one in characteristic zero, so this is just the Eisenstein's theorem, which was I introduced in the previous talk. So it's just n minus 1 over 24 plus sum of like L plus 1, well, n is, L is prime, I mean, for composite level formula. Okay, and so F naught is just the reduction of F0 tilde mod P. So now you want to compute F1, the first higher Eisenstein's elements. I like to call this the higher Eisenstein series, because this is an Eisenstein series, but this is not really an Eisenstein series. This is kind of mod P modular forms, which is kind of a derivative of an Eisenstein series in some sense. The most important thing about the higher Eisenstein series are their Fourier coefficients, their constant Fourier coefficients. I mean, the Fourier coefficients AL for prime L is not very useful for to understand GP. This this is a multi-p modular form. So the elf Fourier coefficient of F1, essentially, if you use Mazur's result, you can show this is just L-1 over 2 log n. So be careful, F1 is only well-defined mod F0. So this, I mean, this is only well-defined mod L plus 1. But I mean, this is non-zero, so I mean, that doesn't make sense. But for all L, this is, I mean, you have a vector L minus 1 over 2 log L, indexed by the prime n. And this vector is unique. This is a well-defined only modulo the vector L plus 1. Okay, so the important fact is the following. Okay, so assume P is greater to 5. From now on, P is always greater equal to 5. I don't want to have complications. So then A naught of F1 is just given by the following formula. It's just proportional to sum of B2 k over n log k. Maybe it's 1 over 6. I don't remember exactly. Okay, so and corollary. A0 of F1, so is greater is 0 mod P. So this is equivalent to the fact that F1 is cuspidal. So by the our abstract theorem, this is equivalent to the fact that GP is greater or equal to 2. So this is equivalent to this quantity order of zeta.
You give this theorem for this row 1. So what type of thing goes into kind of computing?
There is nothing about modular form in this statement. I mean, to compute this, I use other Hecker modules, and then I use some comparison between different Hecker modules to compute constant coefficients. So I almost don't use the theory of modular forms to get this.
Not the theorem, but the statement before.
Yeah. L-1. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. So this follows from the Mazur's results about the Eisenstein ideal. Essentially. Oh, yes. Sorry, this is a proportional. Like, I don't really know the factor. I should look at my paper, but this is like proportional.
What does that mean?
Okay, that means maybe it's 1 over 6 or maybe it's 1 over 12, but I don't know. okay, so you get a new proof of Merrill's. You get a new proof of Merrill's theorem. I mean, if you can compute this in a different way. If you don't use Merrill's theorem to get this identity, then you get a new proof. Okay, so now assume that GP is greater or equal to 2. Then F2 exists, the second higher Eisenstein element. Okay, and you can ask about this constant coefficient. So again, you have a formula. The constant coefficient of F2. This is proportional, again, to sum of e2 bar k over n log k square. I can give you the other Fourier coefficients of F2 in terms of class groups. But for example, a nice particular case is so AL of F2 is log L square. If L is congruent to 1 mod P and N is a p's power mod L, you don't get a clean formula. You get something which is quite complicating involving class groups, but in some cases it simplifies. Okay. This should be related intuitively to square of discrete logarithm, but it's not as simple. So you can determine it using the Galois the trace of the Galois deformation of infinitesimal order 3 or something like this.
Right. So one way to think about it, so you just said you have some Galois representation to kind of f x mod x cube.
Exactly. You take the trace. Yes, but so you get only the coefficient AL, but you don't get the constant coefficients.
Right.
The constant coefficient is the hard part to compute. Right?
Sure. And so, like, but I'm still a bit confused how you're actually proving
these. Ah, yeah. So I will say it a bit later. Okay, so now I will talk about another Hecker module. So this was the first case, the module of Hecker of modular forms. Now let me talk about the supersingular module. So I mean, if I ask you to give me a Hecker module, the first one maybe would be the space of modular forms. The second one would be maybe the supersingular module, I think. Or maybe the homology, I don't know, of some modular curve. So. Okay, so let S be the set of the isomorphism classes of supersingular elliptic curves over Fn bar. So. Okay, so this is a finite set. It's a classical fact that there are only infinitely many supersingular elliptic curves over. And so by the Jane variant function, it's injected into Fn bar, but in fact, it's injected into Fn square. The Jane variant of any supersingular elliptic curve is quadratic over Fn. And so let M be the supersingular module. It's just ZP, the free ZP module with basis element of S. So there is a natural action of the Hecker algebra on this. There's an action of T. For example, TL of an elliptic curve E. So if E is in S, a supersingular elliptic curve, this is just the sum over all subgroup C of E of order L. Order L of the supersingular elliptic curve E mod C. The action is given like this. Okay, so now I have to explain to you what I know about the higher Eisenstein elements in this module. So I will give you the Eisenstein element, which is well known. I think maybe it was Osterle who defined it, or maybe someone before, I don't know. And so I will give you a formula for the first higher Eisenstein element. Okay, so if E is a supersingular elliptic curve, let WE be the half automorphism number. So this is just an element in 1, 2, 3. So let E0 tilde, this is just a sum for all supersingular elliptic curves of 1 over WE times E in M. So this is well known that this is the Eisenstein element. So now also you have a map from M to ZP. This is the degree map. So you send a linear combination of supersingular elliptic curves to the degree, sum of coefficients. So the degree of E0 tilde, this is given by Eschler mass formula. This is sum of 1 over WE, E supersingular. This is just N minus 1 over 12. Eschler mass formula. So the only way I know how to prove this formula in characteristic 0 is to compute, is to relate it to the constant coefficient of the Eisenstein series using theta series. The only proof I know uses analysis, because to get this 1 over 12, you have to compute the zeta minus 1. Oui. Okay, bon, c'est très pratique. Now I will give you the formula for the first higher Eisenstein element and its degree. Just one thing, extend the logarithm to Fn square star, to Fp. I mean, log was defined on the sub on Fn star. there was a map. Here is a, there was a group homomorphism here, and there is a unique way to extend it, because P is odd. Okay, so now there exists some explicit polynomial. So that E1 is given by the following formula: sum for all supersingular elliptic curves, the logarithm of P of the J invariant of E times E. Okay, so this is an element of Fn square star because the J invariant is quadratic. So, but the fact is that this is non-zero, so that you can apply the log. And so I won't give you the formula for P, but I will give you a way to find it yourself. So, and also the second point is that the degree of E1 is proportional to the sum of B2 bar k over n log k. Okay, so the notion of cuspidality, I mean, an element of the supersingular module is cuspidal if and only if its degree is zero. So the degree of E1 is zero mod P. Degree of E1 is zero mod P. This is equivalent to GP greater or equal to 2. So you get another proof of Meres' theorem using only supersingular elliptic curves. If you assume my formula for E1, then the degree is of an elementary computation. Depends just on n. In fact, so this is closely, also there is another polynomial which is closely related to P. Closely related to P, this is the Hasse polynomial. So this is a binomial coefficient like this. Square. So I view it in Fn x, in fact, but okay, the coefficients are integers. So P is strongly related to the derivative of the Hasse polynomial. So there is a simple relation between the two. Okay, but the main player is the derivative of the Hasse polynomial. So let me, so to find this formula E1, it is more convenient to add a gamma 2 structure. And, you don't use just supersingular elliptic curves, but you add an auxiliary basis for the two torsion. And so for some mysterious reason, it's easier to determine the higher Hessian elements in this setting. I don't really understand why, but this is a fact. So so let L be the set, the isomorphism classes of triples E, P1, P2, where E is a supersingular elliptic curve. Okay. And P1, P2 is the basis of the two torsion. Okay, so somehow you don't have any automorphism, so this is more smooth, the formula are more smooth. And so any such triple is isomorphic to another triple, which is a Legendre elliptic curve, E lambda, this is just y squared equals x minus 1, x minus lambda. And the basis is just P1 equals 0, 0. And P2 is just 1, 0. Okay, this is a canonical basis of the Legendre elliptic curve. And so so L, you can identify an element of L with the lambda invariant, the Legendre lambda invariant. So so L is in fact the set of roots Fn bar that H of lambda is zero. This is just the set of roots of the Hasse polynomial, because it is classical that E lambda is supersingular if and only if lambda is the root of H. For example, you can find this in Silverman. so in fact, this is also a subset of Fn square. Okay, so now okay, so L is just this subset of Fn square, and you consider M prime. This is a new Hecker module, but with this additional gamma 2 structure, this ZP L. Okay? So instead of working with gen variant, you work with lambda invariants. And so there is an action of some T prime, some Hecker algebra of this of way 2 and the level gamma naught of N with intersect with gamma 2. And so you have an element E0 tilde prime. This is just the sum of all lambda invariants. So there is no automorphism number here. Okay, SH10 element. So the theorem, the main theorem here for the supersingular module is that if you define E prime, this is just a sum for all lambda in L of the logarithm of H prime of lambda. Okay, this is a it satisfies that TL minus L minus 1 E1 prime is just L minus 1 log L times E0 prime. Okay. And so, okay, you have an element here in M prime mod P. And so if you push it to M mod PM, you get the higher SH10 element. And so you get formula for P taking a resultant between H prime and a degree 6 polynomial relating G and lambda. Okay, so this is the main thing to prove, and this is not, the proof I found uses the algebra of modular forms mod n, in particular the ASO invariant e n minus one and also the modular form e n plus one. But I actually found another proof using Segal units recently. Okay, just out something. Also, to prove the formula for the degree of E1 here, the degree of E1 is proportional to this quantity. You have to understand the discriminant of H. And somehow, mod n, there is a very elementary formula for the discriminant, which is quite surprising because in characteristic zero, you don't have a simple formula. But mod n, because it satisfies some differential equations, then you can compute it. So the discriminant of H is just the product for k equals 1 to n minus 1 over 2, k over k. Just power 4. This is a Merrell's quantity, mod n. Okay. So if you use this formula, then you get the degree of E1. Don't have much time to talk. More about the supersingular module. So E2, I have no formula for E2, but somehow it is. If I understand E1, I can understand the degree of E2. So there is a way to understand this degree without computing E2, and so this is proportional to sum of B2 k over n log k square. So this is a theorem. It is E2, really E2. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So this is quite funny.
So you do mean E2 prime, right?
Yes, there is an E2 prime, yes.
This is on the supersingular module.
Yes. Yeah. So in the J, but I mean it's the same. The degree in the lambda is just the same as the degree in the J. Okay, I won't talk more about the supersingular module because I don't have time. I will talk about modular symbols now. So this is the third Hecker module. Just from this formula, you can deduce some kind of relation between supersingular lambda invariants. Some identity relating the various higher lambda invariants to an explicit quantity like this zeta derivative of a zeta function, and so I don't have an elementary proof of this kind of identities, but it is a consequence of the theory of higher SH10 elements. Um, um, Okay. So n now is just h1 of x0 of n relative to the cusps functioned in ZP, and you take the plus part for the complex conjugation. So there is an action of the Heck algebra on this. And so you denote by, okay, so the Eisenstein's element was determined by Loic, Merel. So what do I mean by computed? So how do you compute the homology of a modular curve on the computer, for example? It is given by the Manin generator. So there is an explicit presentation for this free ZP module with the Manin generator. So, so Manin defined a classic surjection like this, given by sending a matrix gamma naught of n times times g to the modular symbol g0 to infinity. So here, if alpha and beta are in p1 of q, then alpha beta is just the path in the upper half plane between alpha and beta. Okay. So this is a Manin surjection, and so gamma naught n mod SL2 of z, this is a this is canonically identified with the projective line over Fn. Just you take gamma naught of n times ABCD, you send it to CD, so projective coordinate CD. And so what Merel did is he computed this Eisenstein elements in terms of Manin symbols. So these elements here are called the Manin symbols. And recently, with the Barga, Merel found all the Eisenstein elements in for all the possible levels in weight 2. And so this is quite useful. I use this result to compute the higher Eisenstein elements. So theorem, Merel. So E0 tilde is just the sum for all x in for all Manin symbols of psi of x, psi is the Manin surjection, times an explicit function of x. So f naught is an explicit function where ZP if you want. Given like this, you send CD to the sum for this is a formula z to nz square minus 1 over s1 plus s2 Bernoulli. So this is given in terms of Bernoulli polynomials. B1 bar sur 2n. Okay. Okay, this is the formula found by Merel. So this is subject to the condition C minus D S1 plus C plus D S2 is congruent to 0 mod N. It's only a sum for this element. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. So the aim now is to compute the higher Eisenstein elements by finding some function like this. So F1 of CD. So F1 is a function to FP now. It's it takes a Malin symbols to an element in FP. It's given like this. This is a sum for S1, S2, S1. Times the log of times the log of C minus D S1 plus C plus D S2. Okay, so it's the same formula as Merel's formula, but you add a discrete logarithm. I'm lying a bit. There is another term which is kind of the Atkin-Lehner. It's the same term, but you apply some kind of Atkin-Lehner involution. I won't comment about the proof, but Merel's proof was using was in characteristic zero, so he uses this period of Eisenstein series. But and now, the higher Eisenstein element is not related to an Eisenstein series, so there is no a priori there is no hope to compute it in terms of periods or some modular forms. But there is a trick going to gamma one of n, and then there is some kind of Eisenstein series at level gamma one of n, which is related to E1. So somehow, to compute this, you have to compute an Eisenstein element at the level gamma 1 of n. It's something like this. So you use this, your results of Merel and Bebarga, which compute the Eisenstein elements in all for all levels. Okay, then the 7 remaining minutes. I will talk. One thing about this: the boundary of my element. So there is a boundary map to the degree zero cusps. So this is just again this quantity. Okay, times the divisor, the cusp zero minus the cusp infinity. Okay. So again, you get another proof of Merel's theorem if you can compute this. This boundary. Okay. Okay. So now the last one is okay. You take the absolute homology of the open modular curve, and you take the minus part for the complex conjugation. You can ask what are the Eisenstein elements, higher Eisenstein elements. So there is a map from this to the absolute homology group, and the kernel of this map, is one-dimensional because there are only two cusps in prime level. So the kernel of this map is just ZP times one element, which is in fact the higher Eisenstein the Eisenstein element. Okay, so E0 tilde is just a generator, choice of a generator of the map here, of the kernel of the map. So I should say also you have a pairing, M plus the intersection pairing in homology, like this. So this is the relative homology with the plus part for the complex conjugation. This is the absolute homology, but then you have a duality between the two. And so you can normalize E0 tilde by saying that if you evaluate it, so this is bullet, this is the pairing. With the cycle 0 infinity, it's just minus 1. So it's just a normalization. So in fact, you can, because, E1 is only well-defined modulo E0. Okay. Remember that the first regression element is only when defined modulo the SH10 element. And so you don't lose any information if you project E1 to this absolute homology group because E0 is the kernel of this. So with a law of generality, we project E1, E2, and so on in H1 of X0 of N. Okay, so now there is again an intersection duality between this, the minus part and the plus part. So you have an imperfect duality between intersection pairing. So this is echo equivalent. So you can view the higher assertion. So you can view E1, E2, and so on as so in the space of homomorphism from H1 of X0 of N Fp plus 2Fp. So this is an element you can evaluate on the plus part of the absolute homology. And so Maeser essentially showed that E1, when you evaluate it to sum of a combination of Mannian symbols, this is, so X is a Mannian symbol. So this is just essentially sum of lambda X log X. So this is in Fp. And this is what you can get with Maeser's results. So Xi is a Mannian surjection. And so now I will give you a formula for E2, evaluated on a modular symbol, using modulo the truth of the of a conjecture of Sharifi. Okay, you have the following formula. I will just give you the formula. I will evaluate E2 on a specific class of modular symbols, but this will be enough to completely determine E2. So, and the modular symbol Xi of xy, Xi of x, Xi of y. Okay, this is given by some cup product in some K group. So this is for all x, y in z over nz star. This is a subset of P1 of Fn. Okay, so what is this pairing between cyclotomic units? So here, this is the pairing between z, theta n, 1 over n, star 2, the k2. This is the Steinberg symbol, over n. Okay, so this is a Steinberg symbol. So this element, this combination of Steinberg symbols leaves, so there is an action of the group algebra here, z over zn star. And so this leaves minus that plus that, in the augmentation ideal times this k groups, this k, mod the square of the augmentation ideal. Okay, you can do it in this space. But I mean, this could be zero, right? Space could be zero, but it is not zero thanks to the results on the cyclotomic class groups I stated at the beginning of the talk. J is the augmentation ideal, and okay. Just this is mod P. This is mod. So GP is greater or equal to 2. This is equivalent to GK G squared okay. Non-zero. Also equivalently GK well, G squared equivalent to FP. So in fact, these elements are really you can find a canonical isomorphism between this and FP. So because of course to if E2 exists if and only if I assume that GP is greater or equal to 2. So this is an assumption. So this is non-zero, canonically isomorphic to FP, so this is really an element of FP. So it gives a formula for the second higher Eisenstein element. And so in particular, I get some criterion for GP greater or equal to 4 in terms of this kind of pair of cup product. Okay, thank you very much.